Nothing ever changes, despite what people see. Nothing ever changes, nothing ever changes or moves. There is only one true being. Hello, Epicurean Stoic here, and welcome back to my channel. This is video number 6 in my Ancient Greek Philosophy series, and as I promised in the end of my last video after I talked about Heraclitus, this video is about Parmenides and the Eleatics, the philosophical polar opposites of Heraclitus. The Eleatics are also geographical opposites of Heraclitus, in a sense. Thales, Anaximander, Anaximenes, Heraclitus, as well as Xenophanes and Pythagoras, the philosophers we're not covering in this series, were all from Ionia. Xenophanes was from Colophon, and Pythagoras was from the island of Samos, but they both abandoned their homeland of the Greek cities of the East Aegean, traveling all the way west to Magna Graecia. The newer Greek colonies in Sicily and southern Italy were quickly becoming the hot place to be for intellectuals, and this is reflected both in the places where the philosophers that we will be discussing here moved to, and where they were born. The colony that was called Elea was established at around 535 BC, possibly with the presence of Xenophanes, and 2 decades later, Parmenides was born there. Much like the writings of his Ionian contemporary, Heraclitus, Parmenides' writings are not that clear. They're laden with a religious tone that matches the mysticism of Heraclitus, while the style is more of a traditional archaic epic one, rather than the aphoristic style of Heraclitus' poetry. But enough with all that. What did Parmenides say? What did he inherit from the thinkers who came before him, and where did he innovate? Parmenides asked questions about being itself. How and why do things exist? Notice the difference of the phrasing from the questions the natural philosophers from Miletus were asking. Like Heraclitus, Parmenides didn't care much about cosmogony. He didn't ponder about the protearchy and explain how the specific things we see around us came to be from that archy. No, he asked why should things be in the first place? What is the difference between being and non-being? He was possibly a student of Xenophanes who had criticized the Miletians for their lack of empiricism when it comes to the entities they were positing, and yet Parmenides looked for answers in a much different direction from Xenophanes. He disregarded the empirical, the senses and our experiences, and only elevated the rational. He is the first to extensively use logic, forming deductive syllogisms by considering various premises and keeping only those that led to true conclusions necessarily. This, by the way, is the basis of our definition for a valid argument. A valid argument is an argument whose conclusion cannot be false if its premises are all true. Parmenides claimed that we can't ever conceive of nothing as an existing thing because then it wouldn't be nothing, so we have the two fundamental categories, being and non-being. The one that is and that is not possible that it's not, and the other that is not and that it is necessary that it's not. This, Parmenides tells us, is the unshakable heart of well-convincing truth, and all human troubles stem from the fact that we do not grasp that disjunction. Things either are or are not, but people think that both legs of the disjunction are true or both false at the same time. Let's pause for a moment here. So far in this series, I haven't been properly counter-arguing the points of the philosophers I cover, especially because they were the natural philosophers from Miletus, whose observations and conclusions involve stuff like everything is made out of water, which is obviously wrong, and I wanted to focus on the importance of their thought processes. Here though, with Parmenides and the Eleatics, we begin to have properly constructed logical arguments, and so we have the opportunity to argue against them, and argue we shall. If I may speak with a 2,500-year hindsight, Parmenides was at best unlucky with the state of the language of his time, and at worst very confused, conflating different senses of the verb to be. There is, of course, capital B being, the true existence, with the meaning of to be as to exist. This existential meaning of the verb is different from the predicative meaning, where to be is linking an object and a property like the wall is yellow, and yet again from the so-called ease of identity, like 2 plus 2 is 4. Nobody, not even Heraclitus, whom Parmenides probably never knew about anyway, was literally saying that one object can both be and not be at the same time, at least before the advent of quantum mechanics and Schrödinger's thought experiment with the cat. My point is that Parmenides switches between different meanings of to be without changing the argument itself. Sure, being exists necessarily and non-being does not, because it cannot. But this dichotomy only works with that meaning of ine, to be, unless we think that objects can only have one predicate. Well, I might seem too harsh on the Eleatics, but that's exactly what they believed. The only true predicate is the existence one. The only question worth asking is being versus non-being, and so the existence of things, the being, is thought to be necessary, just like the necessary non-existence of non-existent things, the non-being. After he established being itself, Parmenides then moved on to its signs, or attributes, in an equally logic-heavy manner. Being is ungenerated and indestructible, eternal. How could it not have these attributes? If being was born, then it must have come from non-being, which is nothing, and so impossible to exist. And if instead being came from some other being, we also arrive at the contradiction, because how could there be any being other than being itself? Parmenides was, just like Heraclitus, an extreme monist. There is only one being, but unlike Heraclitus' belief that everything is ever-changing, for Parmenides, being is all-encompassing but motionless and unchangeable. The method Parmenides and the other Eleatics, Melissus of Samos and Zeno of Elea, were frequently using, is now called reductio ad absurdum. We start with an assumption we want to disprove, and then, using valid logic steps, we arrive at a contradiction, which means that the initial assumption must be a false one. Parmenides used this method repeatedly to establish all the attributes of being, before moving on to explain seeming, that is the word of human perception, and why it is that we mistakenly think that there are many things that move and change, etc. As we've already seen, he claimed that people fail at grasping the fundamental difference between being and non-being, and this is why they think that there are pairs of opposites, while also coming up with a name that designates each one of the things that look as if they exist to us. Again, this is kind of flimsy, but it is very important because even more than Heraclitus, Parmenides distinguished the rational, logical world of being from the empirical, faulty world of seeming, something that will come up in future videos as well. Now, let's see what Melissus and Zeno added to the conversation. Melissus provided minor quote-unquote corrections to Parmenides' view that being is eternal in an atemporal way, instead arguing that being is eternal in the traditional sense of extended infinitely backwards and forwards in time. Moreover, he argued against motion and change in a couple of interesting ways. Firstly, he said that you need some kind of void, an empty space to move into, if you are to be able to move, and so since there is no void, as being is all-encompassing and spatially infinite, then there cannot be any motion. There's nothing I'll say about this right now, but keep it in mind, because as we'll see next week, this is a key building block for the theories of the atomists. Secondly, Melissus argued against change, essentially saying that if a wall turns from yellow to purple, then what was before, i.e. the yellow wall, perishes, and what is after, i.e. the purple wall, is generated or born, all attributes being the opposite of the attributes of being. Again, I'll be a bit harsh and point out that Melissus, like Parmenides, confuses two meanings of to be. When we say the wall is yellow and the wall is purple, we're using is in the predicative sense. When we say the wall is the same wall as before, we're using is in the is of identity sense. So the contradiction of the coexistence of sameness and difference does not apply. Think of it this way, using a favorite example of philosophers when it comes to is of identity questions. Let's accept the truth of the statement, Clark Kent is Superman. We can also accept Bruce Wayne is Batman. But since Superman is not Batman, then Clark Kent is not Bruce Wayne is also true. This argument works and is fine because we never switch between different senses of the word is. In the wall example, however, when we say the wall is yellow, we are not actually equating the wall with the color yellow, and so this is where the argument of Melissus and by extension Parmenides fails. Finally, we have Zeno of Elea, with his infamous four paradoxes, which are equally preposterous in that they support the view that motion, change and plurality are all impossible, so the only true conclusions are the existence of only one single being, which is immovable and unchanging. At the risk of making the video too long, let me talk about one of his paradoxes. It is called the dichotomy paradox. Imagine an athlete that must do a 100 meter run. Well, first, she has to run the first half, so 50 meters. Once she does that, she has to run the next half of the remaining distance, so 25 meters, then 12 and a half meters, and so on and so forth. Now, we don't even need to have her stop between every step. Any finite distance can be split into an infinite number of smaller distances. Zeno then asks, how can the athlete ever cover an infinite number of finite distances? It was self-evident for him that an infinite number of tasks cannot be completed, and if the athlete cannot do that, then there's no distance that she can move to, so just like all things we think we see around us, she's stationary and immobilized due to the simple mathematical fact that the sum of an infinite amount of numbers cannot possibly be finite. Well, I lied there, that's not a mathematical fact. It was accepted as a fact in Zeno's time, and it actually took more than 2 millennia until Augustin Louis Cauchy showed that you can definitely get a finite number as the sum of an infinite amount of numbers in what are known as the convergent infinite series, or Cauchy series. So it's okay that she has to undertake an infinite number of tasks, namely run an increasingly smaller and smaller distance. In the end, she can actually cover a finite distance overall, which is 100 meters. Another paradox that is interesting to just mention is the arrow paradox, which follows a similar route but for time, and it took until the robust development of calculus with Newton and Leibniz to show why Zeno is wrong in calling these things paradoxes. In both cases, despite the absurdity of their conclusions, Zeno's paradoxes asked questions that took thousands of years to answer properly. And even if the Eleatics were using paradoxes and arguments like those to support their false beliefs that motion, change, and plurality are impossible, they were asking deep and profound questions about the nature of reality, as well as dealing with the fundamental issue within both physics and philosophy, change. They challenged their contemporaries to provide adequate answers to these questions or refute their conclusions, and funnily enough, no answer that was given was the right one until the 18th and 19th centuries. To take a quote out of context, Oppenheimer said, "Any man whose errors take 10 years to correct is quite a man." And the errors of the Eleatics, at least as exemplified in Zeno's paradoxes, took 200 times 10 years, so they are indeed quite the men. Once again, thank you very much for watching this video, and if you've enjoyed it, press like and subscribe to my channel. You can watch all the videos in this series here, and if you're more into video essays about modern films and TV series, you can check my other series here. Next week, we will talk about the rest of the so-called pre-Socratics I want to cover, namely Empedocles and the Atomists, but until then, have a great day, sing the Eleatic Rhapsody, and as always, seek virtue.